Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the INVO event of the Food System in 10 Years Challenge. My name is Miriam Troost. I'll be your moderator today, and I'm also the coordinator, a coordinator of the Student Challenges team of Wageningen University and Research. Today in the program, there are also some experts. We see here Stijn Reinhardt. Maybe you can wave. Yeah, thank you very much, Stijn. And there's Ivo Demmers. Hello, thank you very much. And then Joost Snels. Okay, thanks a lot. So you will meet them later on in the program. So what will happen today? This event will take 1 hour from 4 to 5 p.m. This is our welcome, so this is already done. After me, Ivo will talk about the challenge. So he will tell you more about the procedure, about milestones, and also what you can win with the challenge. After that, Stijn Reinhardt will talk about a food system approach. You can see this as a mini lecture, so take good notice, and so you can use this in the challenge yourself. After that, Joost Snels will talk about changes in the food system after COVID-19, also a mini lecture. After that, there are questions and answers about the challenge and the introductions. So please use the chat function. You can post your questions in the chat. Maybe we can already answer them during the session, so then we will start typing right away. Otherwise, we will post your question in the question and answers session and answer it. Then we will close with closing remarks, but that will be in 1 hour. So I want to ask Ivo now to continue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Miriam, for the very kind introduction. I'll take you along the challenge we have stipulated for you. Firstly, I would like to introduce myself. I work on food systems approach, and I work within Wageningen since 2014 on the combination of food, environment, and water. This particular challenge is about how are we going to feed the world. Well, that's a big challenge. It's even becoming bigger due to the COVID-19 stress we see, and that is what sparked us in putting and helping now and asking for your help as a student of Wageningen University in solving the challenge. What the food system approach entails will be introduced by Stijn Reinhardt a bit later. But in looking forward 10 years ahead from now, so envisage you're in 2030 and see a new food system has arrived. Since 2020, what are the changes we need to change? What are the things we have to do, and what are the things we just don't have to do? And on the content side, that's a difficult question: balancing nutrition, balancing production, balancing inclusive value chains, and balancing environmental stresses of our food system. Let alone doing that on a local level, but also including the global perspective of it. With this challenge, we would like to invite you to think along with groups of four or five or six people and come up with solutions by combining your left and your right brain. As the left brain is more focused on verbal and analytical aspects, the right part of the brain is on visual and intuitive parts. And with this challenge, we want to bridge the gaps between those two hemispheres. We're not doing that alone. We are combining a very nice set of creative people who are working today in the World Food Center in Ede, and combining the best experts of Wageningen University and Research. And those are the experts we would like to offer to you, to the teams of 4 to 6 persons, interdisciplinary teams, so you're not tackling the issue from one angle only. And working together to finding solutions which will last 10 years and will really take into account the question not only what to change, but also how are we going to change. And that's where we need the combination of the left and the right brain. We have a prize, €500 for the winning team. But besides that, it's really going to be great fun and working together with us, with the creative guys in the World Food Center. And besides that, we will take all the participants, but especially, of course, the winners of the competition in the communication of Wageningen University and Research, but also in the World Food Center. The criteria which we are going to use in judging the challenge is content on food system, which will be expressed by Stijn in a minute. But your proposal also have to be compelling to especially others who don't work in the food system as of today. So I would like to give the floor to Stijn in a minute. First, talk about the milestones, registration 17 September. Then the phase one starts with the teamwork. What you have to come up with then is a short pitch to be delivered on the 16th of October. And then you will be offered a creative workshop on creative thinking by the people in ADA, in the World Food Center. After that, the creative part of the journey starts in phase two, where the team works together not only with Wageningen experts, but also with the creative professionals in designing it can be anything, can be a video presentation or whatever being presented in the beginning of December at the award ceremony, which probably will take place in the very nice Stinger Bowl, which you saw on this picture. And the Stinger Bowl you get more acquainted to in 16th of October when you get a tour in this magnificent building in Ede. But that will be also the location where we want to present the outcome of the challenge. So these are the milestones. I would like to invite Stijn on stage to take us along on the food system approach. Stijn, take it away.
Thank you, Ivo. Good afternoon. My name is Stijn Reinhardt. I'm a senior scientist on food security and water security at Wageningen Economic Research in The Hague. We selected in Wageningen one framework for all our food security research to stimulate synergy between our projects and to build new knowledge on top of the current projects we are doing. Use a food system approach to address the challenges in achieving preset goals, such as the sustainable development goals, and food systems are highly complex systems, encompassing all the stages to feed the population. So agricultural production, harvesting, packing, marketing, consuming and disposing of food is all part of the food system and also part food system approach. So the figure you see here on the screen is a schematic representation of the food system and describes the food system approach. The food system approach consists of four segments that are depicted in different colors on this figure. On the right-hand side are the food system outcomes, so the food security outcomes and the food system outcomes are on top, and the environmental outcomes are on the lower part of the right-hand side. The socioeconomic drivers are presented in orange in the top part of the picture. The environmental drivers are green at the lower part, and they consist of, for instance, climate, biodiversity, and water. And the food system activities itself are in blue in the center part of the figure. They consist, for instance, of agriculture production, food processing, and amongst all the things. The advantage of a food system approach is that it forces us to define the desired outcomes of the food system and enables us to analyze the relationships and the dynamics between different parts of the food system to arrive at the desired outcomes, which are depicted at the right-hand side gray part. It provides insights in the interdependencies of the example, for example, food production, processing, distribution, and consumption, giving, for instance, socioeconomic and environmental changes. So the framework offers at least three benefits. First, the food system approach helps us to define goals. In most cases, these goals relate to national or regional food and nutrition security. Second, it enables us to understand the national or local socioeconomic and environmental drivers that define the context of the food system activities that are depicted in the center blue part. Third, it helps us to map and include relevant parts of the food system required to achieve the set goals. So when doing detailed work on crops, animals, farms, or any other specific area within the food system, it is still essential to understand how your work is embedded in the food system entirely. So if you're aiming on improving productivity or increase efficiency, you do not necessarily align with goals such as farm income or food security. And if you have the food system approach in mind, you can see all these relations within this representation, and you are aware of these relations, so you can analyze them and take them into account. The drivers and processes influencing the goals will differ for each specific case. So for each case, the orange and green drivers will be different and will need different data or different information. And the food system also aims to connect different scientific disciplines and tools, such as farm system analysis, value chain analysis, and network analysis, and consumer behavior. But the food system signals the interdependencies, but doesn't provide readily available tools to make this connection. So you have to find these tools yourself and use the right tools to elaborate these interconnections. System thinking also broadens the perspective and seeking solutions for the root causes of problems such as poverty, malnutrition, and climate change. Different narratives about the failure of food systems exist. So in this picture, four different narratives of the failure of the food system are depicted, and the food system approach is in the center. So an important paper of Ben et al. Have distinguished these four different narrative here depicted. So, for instance, the top left quarter of the figure says that the inability of the food system to feed the world. So research is focused on this narrative. Are mostly food security researchers who are focused on closing the yield gap, for instance. The inability to deliver healthy diet on the right-hand side upper part of the figure is analyzed by researchers focusing on nutrition security, and they are focused on closing the nutrient gap or high-quality diet. The bottom left part of is the narrative of the inability of the system to produce equal and equitable benefits. So researchers here are focused on social justice and decentralization. And the lower right-hand side part of the figure is the narrative on unsustainability of the system. So here the focus is on natural resources, and they're aiming to reduce the footprint. The food system approach can be used to integrate these four narratives and to analyze trade-off in attaining four different goals in the same time, because you can't have win-win-win situation or all those four different goals of these four narratives. So trade-offs will be necessary, and you have to make them very clear how these trade-offs will look like and what the effects are of attaining one goal for the other three narratives. In the article, which is referred to in this slide, a framework for a sustainable food system is put forward. Now I will give the floor to the next speaker.
Thank you, Stijn. Well, I will go into, well, not the food system approach, but I will get a little bit in depth and hope start the discussion already, maybe in the chat, but eventually I hope afterward in the teams of what changes after the, well, the COVID pandemic that we are all talking about. As Ivo also said during the introduction, we like to take you to step 10 years from now to see we're living in a system, in a world that is different by default after 10 years. But when looking back, what changes, what changed in the food system? So that's what we are looking at. And as Stijn just mentioned, well, we're looking in a food system approach. So that's quite complex, but it also gives its guidance in how to approach certain changes or certain transitions that are needed. And I just showed in this slide also even more complex maybe, but also the dependency and also the system approach related to what the effects are of a pandemic like COVID-19. What you see here, it's I saw a question somewhere in the chat that are the slides available? Yes, they are. So at the end, you can zoom in and see maybe in more detail what was presented here. But what it shows is that a pandemic like COVID, or let's say that a lot of people are not able to work or get sick or not able to consume the amount of food that they like to consume, it has a huge effect on food and agriculture. So that's in the left side of this figure. So that's the larger bullet. But what you also see in between is that there is a lot of interrelations and indirect results and indirect things getting related to the COVID-19 pandemic. So it's not only food and agriculture, but it's also the availability of water. It's also the availability of electricity and fuel, for example. When people get sick or not able to get to go to work and they are not able to refine the nice petrol that we need, then also the machines that are working on the land are not able to do the things that they have to do. So that's also a lot of relations in between. So it's just more than the food system on sich, and just the food system as it is. So just the flows of foods all over the world. It's also the interrelationships. So that's what I would like to show. And also I hope that everybody can take into account when they're looking at solutions and also the effect on certain solutions. So that's in this slide. In the middle, you see also things like water, but also sanitation. So that's a really major effects that maybe it's not the first thing everybody's thinking about when we're covering topics like COVID-19. But it is essential in at the end, the solution that we have to look at. So maybe the food system approach is already challenging, but I think this is also puts a top on it. But it also gives you a nice way to work towards a solution and be creative in what the effects will be in relation to the solution that I come up with as a team. The other thing that you see, and that's what most people look at when you look at the food system, is the pressure points in this the food system at the moment. And one of the major things is also what people realize in their daily living is that some type of foods are not available anymore. And that's because we are really highly dependent, and that's what is in this slide, on transportation and moving foods and staple goods, but also fresh and vegetable foods all around the world. It's not often the case that the food that's produced in one country is also eaten in the same country. Often it's produced somewhere else in the world and then it's transported for long distances all over the world to being able to feed people. So that's in this slide from the Rabobank. It's looking at only fruits. You have the same for vegetables, for example. And what you see in this case is that a lot of fruits are not coming from Europe, but they are eaten in Europe. So you could imagine that once production fails because people are sick, but also once transportation fails because we are not able to deliver the petrol that is needed, or to get the people on board on the ships and the vessels to really do the transportation. So when it fails, the whole system tends to collapse or break down. So that's one of the things that is really, everybody knew it more or less, but that's really the pressure point that COVID showed. That's one thing. And the other thing is also that, it's all more or less just in time. We don't like stocks because quality decay is always there. So we don't want certain stocks of, let's say, strawberries or tomatoes. So we want to keep that as minimum as possible. So we don't have any buffer in our supply chain. So it's one hiccup maybe we can overcome. But a hiccup for more than 2 or 3 weeks, it's really, really a problem. Yeah, we saw that even a couple of years ago when there was one of the volcanoes at Iceland that erupted. Even for 4 or 5 days, we were not able to fly, and we really saw that the system tended to collapse. Luckily, we stabilized after a couple of weeks, but COVID, we don't get that stabilization yet. So and the other thing that's also, when I showed the first picture, that's just one point I like to highlight, is that it's more than just the production of the food within the system. It's also about all the other inputs that a farm, for example, needs. It's not just the seeds, but it's also the nutrition, the fertilizer, the chemicals, the equipment, the technology, the animal, the animals you need probably, and also the food for your labor, but also the feed for your animals. And of course, labor, that I highlighted it there. So it's more pressure in your system than just somebody's not able to produce the food because his workforce is ill. It's more than that. But labor is really an issue. And as one of the researchers showed that from the National Infrastructure Simulation Analysis Center in the United States, they show that even a 10% shortage in labor, then it's a reduction already in the food production of about 25% and even more. And what you saw in the pandemic like we are facing right now, it's the shortage of labor is between 20 and 40%. So you could imagine that the system really is slowing down, and that's quite an issue. So when you're looking at how to change or how to make the food system in the future more resilient, labor could be one of the things to tackle. Some other that's more the indirect effects as I see them is it's not only people getting sick, but it's also that people lose some kind of income because they are not able to get to work. And when they are lose income, they can consume less, and then you can in a vicious circle that is trickling down and down and downward slope. So that's one effect stress the other. So it's not only getting sick, but it's also that factory has to close down because they have less the workforce is a little bit little than they expected, so they have to close down. Maybe then people lost their income, and so it the trickle down effect is really there. What we also saw is that especially the informal economies are they are hit at the hardest. What we see in Africa now and in Latin America, and these people are they are not able to stay at home because they have to get their food every day. So they don't have a buffer or no buffer income. And the system is not organized in such a way that you can go to a supermarket and buy your foodstuffs for a week or 2 weeks. No, you really have to do it day by day. Also, you have to earn your income day by day. So then staying at home or an evening clock is really hard. So that you see that we say that COVID-19 doesn't discriminate, but the food system or the country people live in, the discrimination starts more or less. So that's also something we have to take into account, I think. And the last one is also, it's a simplified figure, but it's that we have some direct effects. The pandemic is there. When you look at the figure, the arrow below, and then you saw that there is less people have their login in place, and then you saw that there was causing a rush on grocery stores and other goods, even in a country like the Netherlands. And what you saw that is the direct effect that some countries, and I have a picture later on, that they started to implement food protectionist measures to safeguard the food. So what you saw, that's the instantaneous reaction. People tend to cope with it. But what you see, and that's bullet number four, just to say, is that they implement things for a longer duration than just the COVID pandemic that's happening. So that's also what you see on the upper side of this simplified figure, is that you saw that in the first case, people get to log in and they lose income and they lose their work maybe. And then you see that companies are starting to change how they cope with the workforce and the people getting to work. So you see that the long-term effects could be even more drastic than we see at the moment. So that's also when we face 20 or 10 years from now, that's quite something to take into account. And this one you can read once the slides are available, but it's just an overview of food protectionism that took place just after the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic rears his or her ugly head. I don't know what it is, but it's really there. And the main question is, does it stay there or does it change back to an old new after we find a medicine or something like that? And is it all bad? So this is my last slide. Is it all bad news? Well, I just quote Winston Churchill. At least they say that the quote is from him, that never waste a good crisis. What you also see is that because of a crisis like this, that a lot of pre-coronavirus trends, they're accelerating at the current moment. So things that we already try to move on or try to put in place is to see that they are speeding up. That's the figure below. But also what we really see is the decentralized food system. So it's not the pictures I showed of all the fruits and vegetables traveled all over the world. You see that it's decentralized a little bit more, and that's a movement that's really in place. Also decommoditization, that's not a one size fits all, a product that everybody likes. So it's more diversification in the food and the types of food that you deliver all over the world. And the third D is digitalization. That's really a thing that's getting into place. It's not only a webinar like this or a webinar jam that we all sit behind our computer, but it's also the food system as a whole. So what you see, it's bad news, but the creativity, I think, that as a team is how to translate it in something new, something good, and what are the effects on the longer term. So that's what I wanted to present. So I now probably hand it over to the moderator, and I will close my mic.
Yeah, thank you very much, Joost and Stijn, for your mini lectures. We didn't get so many questions yet for the experts. So you can still put your questions in the chat. Meanwhile, I will pick up the question of Anita. When, where can we form the team, since I don't know anyone? Well, there might be more of you that don't know anybody who signed up for this info event. You can see there are around 40 students signed up and are interested. Some of you already have a team in mind. So you can register with 4 to 6 people through the registration form. If you are an individual, you can register on your own. If you are with 2 or 3 persons, you can register with the 2 or 3 persons. But then we will combine you with another small group. What we will do is the deadline will be the 17th of September, 5 p.m. After that, we will gather all the names. And we will put teams together. So on the 18th, we will notify you of your team and also your expert. So we will immediately combine you with an expert. So you can start working immediately after the 18th. I hope this will answer your question, Anita. Can you tell me in the chat if you know enough by now? Yeah, so what Linda is doing in the chat, we can also you can also, if you would like us to you can always send an also an email to studentchallenges@verb.nl if you found somebody that that you would like to cooperate with. Olivia, you are asking, will the teams be formed based on our study program? Yeah, we would like to have interdisciplinary teams, but it's not necessary. So we will not even put you together with your same study program. Florian, if you are already a team of four, then we will leave you as a team of four. So four, five, or six persons in a team, that's enough. So if you register with four persons, that will be your team. We will not put extra people in your team. How much, Lisanne is asking, how much time would it cost to join this challenge? Okay, that's a totally different question. Let me see if there are more questions about the teams. And I'll mark this, only students. Nora is asking also another question. We'll do that later. Thank you. Okay, Anita says she knows enough. Anita and Linda, I will give you your email addresses, okay? So each other's email addresses. Okay, I see that Anita already made a whole team. We will still see the chat afterwards, so we will go through it in detail. So we have some questions left about time commitment and some question about the creative procedure.
Yes.
So I think, Ivo, maybe you can tell us a little bit more about our cooperation with the creative companies.
Yes, thank you. In looking of ways of combining the left and the right parts of the brain, we run into several artists and creative companies working on the verge of art and communication. And they were very interested in helping the participants of the challenge out in displaying their IDs. So in the second phase of the program, so after your pitches on World Food Day on 16th of October, the teams will be strengthened with experts from particularly one or two companies to help materialize the way and the visibility of your IDs. And then we come back to the Stinger Ball. Why the Stinger Ball? That is a leftover of a military training center in Ede, and is now a place where all kinds of creativity and artists come together. Last weekend there was a nice show making very nice use of the room, and that's also why we are inviting you to participate in the in joining the event on 16th of October and seeing what you can do in the Stinger Ball. So a tour around that Stinger Ball, and that's basically a very open, hollow space and a very nice place to make use of in presenting your IDs. But it will not only be at that specific location. We're really also looking for something which will be used in future, also in virtual exhibitions. Example, of that is the virtual exhibitions where Wageningen participates, but also where the World Food Center participates. So that's also one of the ways of presenting your work, not only in December of this year, but also onwards. So I hope that answers that question. Miriam, you looked at the chat, I believe.
Yeah, there's another question about the time commitment.
Yeah. I think it's good. I can give a shot in answering that one. It is two phases. In designing the challenge, we thought of a couple of meetings running up to the 16th of October to come together with, as a team, presenting the pitch and the ID. So indeed, if you look into the amount of weeks left till 16th of October, I believe it was Nora, right, asking the question, a couple of nights. That could be true. And then in the second phase, a bit more in more detailing your ideas. So will be a couple of nights, like three in the time running up the 16th, and then in the second phase a bit more, but still a confined amount of time. Is that yep. enough?
That might be enough on the time. But Nora is asking, can only students participate? Can no students participate for the presentations?
Yeah. Well, the challenge is designed for students, particularly in the presentations. There will be ample time and room to also include non-students. If you have a very good idea of including non-students, I think it's good to talk a bit on that, because if it strengthens your ID, I think it's good.
Yeah, so Nora, basically, I think maybe you can send us an email to studentchallenges@verb.nl to tell us your ideas. So I think we are running through all the questions. If anybody has a question, still put it in the chat. And otherwise, I think we should end now with the concluding remarks. Yeah. Okay. Let's do the concluding remarks. So I hope you all got some idea about the challenge. If there are any questions left, just email us at studentchallenges@ver.nl. You can see the email address now in the in screen. Well, as said before, registration before the 17th of September, 5 p.m. At the website. In the chat, we saw some of you teaming up. Lisanne, I see that you still see. Did you see my question? Let me see what. Oh, is the teamwork always on Wednesdays, or can you plan that yourself with your team? Yeah, you can plan that yourself with your team. And with the expert, actually. So what will happen after the 18th, you all register before the 17th, and we will make the teams. And you'll start working with the expert. The expert will take the lead in the beginning and knows more about the further process. So you can plan any day you like. The 16th of October is important to keep that day free, because then we will, if COVID-19 allows us, we will be in Ede at the World Food Center, and you will all have an excursion in the Stinger Bowl. We were there actually last week, and it's really impressive. It's I don't know if you all know the Omniversum in The Hague. It's like if you look up, you can make a whole screen, and the sound in that Stinger Bowl is really fantastic. So it's really exciting for us to connect you with multimedia professionals to make your ideas in a creative form also available for the public. So the 16th of October is quite important. You also receive that day a workshop. So that's at least one day that you should keep free. And we are working on a date beginning of December. So also put that in mind, that we will, I think we will have the details very soon.
There's one question on how to get into contact through the participants. Can we provide some email addresses, or how is that going to work?
Yeah. That's a bit difficult for us because of privacy regulations. But what I can do is we can think of making a Facebook group, a closed Facebook group, that we will send a link to all of you, so you can start connecting with each other. that might be a good way to get to know each other a little bit and also put some adverts for your own team, actually. So, I hope everybody will agree. It's a pity that you cannot talk to us only through the chat. But I think we'll make the group, and I'll send you the link tomorrow, so you can you can register for that group. I will put you in, and then we'll think of a way to for you guys to connect. Okay.
I see one more of Anita. For relatives to participate in presentations?
It's even possible that part of the presentations will be online. And Ivo was talking also about a virtual exhibition that we are planning. So that's for sure available for relatives. But yeah, it's very difficult to tell you right now if what is possible and what's not. On campus, it's really strict, but since we are at the World Food Center, there are different rules there. So we are still discussing the things that are possible. And the Stinger Bowls, actually, yeah, just look it up also on YouTube and all, because it's really an interesting building. And there are some artists already performing there. So it might be possible, but we cannot promise you anything yet. Okay. So I guess this is it. We can we will send you an email tomorrow with this recording. We will send you the presentation. We will send you the PDF file of the food system approach, and we will send you a link to the Facebook group. And I'll keep you posted for everything. And thank you very much for your attention. And thank you, Ivo. Thank you, Joost. Thank you, Stijn. Hello, Joost, coming back. Stijn, are you there? Yeah, hi. So, we are looking forward to working with you guys, because we really need some good ideas. And this is really a topic that's worldwide very important right now. You even see that the United Nations, they're planning a food systems summit in 2021. So it's really, something that's, things will happen in this topic, in these years.
Just one remark from my side, that was can people attend? We line up with the World Food Day, and there's also a larger event on the 16th of October. So we are looking in ways to combine that, so that's maybe even more interesting for people to visit it. And the other thing is, it was for me nice to see that people already teaming up, so that's good. One remark from my side is also people that are not in a team yet, still that is possible. So we will put you in a team. So it's you don't really have to team up now. So it's nice, of course. Yeah. But even if you're alone there, out there, we will get you in a team. So it's really possible to participate. And we really like people to get acquainted with new people also. Yeah.
Okay. So it's a wrap, I think. We will meet you all soon, and good luck with your teams. Thank you.
Cheerio.
Bye-bye.